The following show is based on historical records and may reflect language or socio-political attitudes that were, while not appropriate to use in 2018, used in the era being discussed. Listener discretion is advised.
I am human, I am love, and my heart beats in my blood. Love will always win, underneath the skin. Everybody's got a pulse. Everybody's got a pulse.
Welcome to Beautifully Broken. I'm your host, Stephanie Soberon. Today on Beautifully Broken, we're talking about persons with disabilities that rock the world. When you hear the names Harriet Tubman or Franklin Delano Roosevelt, do you think disabled? No? Well, most people are completely unaware that many acts of bravery, innovation, or socio-political progress have been achieved by persons with disabilities. In this episode, we learn about the change makers who just happen to have a disability. People who made the world sit up and take notice, changed attitudes, and challenged the status quo.
When Israel was in Egypt's land, let my people go. Oppressed so hard they could not stand, let my people go. Moses, way down in Egypt's land, tell all Pharaoh to let my people go.
When I bring up Harriet Tubman, the former slave, who led many people to freedom on the Underground Railroad, as someone with a disability, people are always very surprised. But according to historical records, she suffered with seizures caused by being hit on the head with the weight as a child.
Harriet Tubman was also a warrior. She helped John Brown plan his attack on Harper's Ferry in 1859, and during the Civil War was the first woman ever to lead an armed raid into enemy territory.
Speaking with me today about Harriet Tubman's life is Kate Clifford Larson, Ph.D., author of Harriet Tubman, Portrait of an American Hero, Bound for the Promised Land.
Welcome to the show, Kate.
Thank you for having me.
Now, with Harriet Tubman, and for our listeners who don't know, was born Araminta Ross in 1822. She led such a remarkable life considering her beginnings. And you write that her father was an early conductor on the Underground Railroad and was a huge influence on her. Can you tell us about that?
Oh, I'd love to talk about this because I think that her father doesn't get the credit that he deserves. So her father was a very well-respected man, and he was given his freedom in 1840 when he was probably 55 years old. And he was able to earn a good income for himself, and he lived in a place that was very conducive to helping people escape on the eastern shore of Maryland off the Chesapeake Bay. And I think that he was such a smart and well-respected man. He was not someone that came under suspicion. So he just used his skills of deception and the place where he lived to be able to help people escape. And I think he imparted some really great information to Tubman about survival, paying attention to the landscape, paying attention to what's going on around you. And those skills that he imparted on her helped her survive when she became an Underground Railroad conductor herself.
And it seems like just the strength that she had physically and mentally, despite her disability her whole life, it seems like maybe she got some of that from him too.
I think so. I think that she obviously was born with something about her that gave her this strength and courage and confidence, but she had this father that I believe nurtured that in her as well. At a time when enslaved people were not given much credit for anything, not well respected, and enslaved women in particular were discredited, frequently discarded, not paid attention to. So she grew up in an environment where her father respected her, her mother certainly did, and I think she just absorbed all this from her family, her father, her community, so that she took what she could from them and was able to be incredibly successful.
It gave her a strong sense of self that she may not have otherwise had.
Yeah, and it was also her strong faith. She was incredibly spiritual, and she had this sensibility about the universe and the world around her, and that there was a higher being that was sort of guiding her in some ways, so that she had a confidence that whatever decision she was making was a good decision. And sometimes she credited that with the God that she believed in.
And most people that I have talked to, you know, they know that she was spiritual, they know some things about her, but they don't know a lot about her, and especially the fact that she had a disability, which was probably temporal lobe epilepsy from the head injury that she had gotten as a child. Can you talk about that and how it affected her for the rest of her life?
Sure. So when she was about 13, she was hit in the head from an iron weight at a dry goods store. You know, they have scales on the counters and there are weights to weigh like flour and things like that. And she was involved in an altercation at a local store in Dorchester County, Maryland. And an overseer threw the weight at another enslaved person, but it hit Tubman, who was 13 at the time, right in her head. And it cracked her skull. And it nearly killed her. So after recovering for several months, her mother nursed her back to health. There was no medical care to speak of. She came out of that injury, where she was unconscious for a while, suffering from seizures. And based on things that Tubman said throughout her life and people who observed her and talked about her, it seems that she suffered from temporal lobe epilepsy, which is a form of epilepsy that is often triggered by a very severe head injury. And some of the symptoms that she had were included, she would have a seizure and she would like fall to the ground like she had passed out. But she was aware of what was going on around her. She just could not move. She couldn't stir herself. So she could hear people talking, and then she would come out of the seizure and she would be okay. Sometimes she had a lot of visionary activity. She would see fire, or she would hear things like people singing when no one was singing near her. Sometimes she would have really bad dreams, but she was awake and she would have these visions of bad things happening. Sometimes she imagined that she was floating above the earth and looking down at the ground below her and the people below her. And these are all typical symptoms of people who have temporal lobe epilepsy. It's called TLE. And so she suffered with this for the rest of her life. Now, today, people who have that can be medicated, and it mitigates some of the symptoms. But for Tubman, there was no medication for it. So she just incorporated the seizures into her life, and she accepted them. They would come and go. And she believed that the voices that she heard were angels or God speaking to her. She was comforted sometimes by the seizures because it made her very calm, and she would feel, you know, sort of rested after the seizure was over. So it just became part of her life, and it was okay, and she would get up and move on after the seizure was over. So she just didn't let it slow her down. She just kept moving. And so that's kind of a remarkable thing about someone who was suffering these seizures in the middle of the field when she was working or along the Underground Railroad. But she just felt that there was a higher power that was protecting her. And I guess we can't argue with that, because something protected her along the Underground Railroad days, that's for sure.
Well, exactly. And I think it probably, what the purpose that she had, it seems like, drove her to push through all of that despite the seizures.
Right. Right. That's a great observation, right?
Yeah. And she had sleeping spells as well, right? Or was that was part
of the
seizure?
That's the same thing. So in the 19th century, when the first biographies were written about Tubman, they called them sleeping spells because they didn't know what epilepsy was. They just said, oh, she had sleeping spells. But that's really, she was having seizures.
Okay.
As a result of that head injury.
That makes sense. After she escaped slavery in 1849, what drove her to risk her freedom by repeatedly turning to where she'd been enslaved? Because as you've noted in your book, it was rare for an Underground Railroad conductor to return to their original home.
So she returned because of her family. She missed them. It was the people that she loved desperately. She felt deserved to be free as well. And she was in Philadelphia, and it was filled with free black people who were living full lives, and she felt that all people should be living the same way. And she gained the confidence after running away herself. She did it successfully. She knew that there were people willing to help. So she thought that, you know, her life would be worth risking in order to bring her family and loved ones to freedom.
Incredible. The fact that she did risk her life, because so many people escaped and didn't go back. So that just shows you the person that she was. What is known, or even the approximate number of how many people Harriet Tubman led to freedom or advised in their escape?
So we have some pretty good ideas. She gave many lectures in the northern states after she escaped and towards the end of the 1850s. And in her lectures, she talked about rescuing 50 to 60 people in 8 or 9 trips into Maryland. But we've been able to document about 13 trips, and she rescued about 70 family and friends. So, and we were able to name many of them. And then she also gave instructions to other people who used her network of Underground Railroad agents and the routes that she used. There were probably another 70 more people who used her instructions, and they escaped on their own, and they made it north successfully.
And she also incorporated many ways of doing it, such as disguises and things like that. And there's one story that you tell about when she's on the bridge talking about husbands. And I love this story. Can you please tell our audience about this?
So she is escorting a group of enslaved people across, or they're approaching a bridge in Wilmington, Delaware, and they need to get across it. And it was in November, and she's very nervous. And they run across a group of Irish laborers. And oftentimes there were altercations between black laborers and Irish laborers. There was competition for jobs, et cetera. And she was nervous that these Irish laborers would hassle her group, or they might figure out that they were freedom seekers trying to escape slavery. So rather than hide from them or kind of try to get away from them, Harriet Tubman waltzed right up to the men and started engaging them in a conversation about Christmas. Well, the Irish laborers, the men, were not impressed with her, you know, kind of dissembling and talking about Christmas, and they were getting curious about what she and the group of people were doing on the bridge. So she started engaging them in a conversation about a husband. She told them that she had married an African-American man the first time, and basically he wasn't faithful, and that marriage didn't last, so she was thinking she might marry a white man this time. Now, given the racial dynamics of the 1850s, this was really shocking, and the men got all nervous, and they started laughing, and she started laughing, so they all walked across the bridge safely together with the men laughing. Tubman had kind of destabilized them enough so that they didn't pay attention to the fact that these freedom seekers were trying to escape slavery. She was just brilliant and courageous.
She really was.
It is a great story. Yeah, it is a great story.
And there were so many examples that you used of that, that to talk to her must have been incredible, because she just seemed to have such a wry sense of humor and observations.
Yeah, and very quick thinking on her feet, that's
yeah,
for sure.
Exactly, and dressing like men at times, and just
right,
all of the things that she did in order to escape capture, or, you know, escape being caught while she was trying to help people. Just unbelievable.
Right. Yeah, and she was a great observer of people and the way they thought. And so she would disguise herself as an old woman. So people really didn't pay attention to an older black woman. They weren't going to be concerned with her. Or she dressed as a middle-class black woman, fine clothing, and so they wouldn't assume that she was an enslaved person. She just knew how she would be perceived, and she worked it to her advantage.
Brilliant. Absolutely brilliant. And there was a myth that there was a $40,000 bounty on her head. What, I know that was a myth, but what perpetuated it?
So the only reward for her capture was a $100 reward that was posted in the newspaper in 1849. The slaveholders in Maryland had no idea that it was Harriet Tubman, the disabled enslaved person who ran away in 1849, Minty Ross. They didn't know that it was her that was helping people escape from the eastern shore of Maryland. After the Civil War, towards the end of the 1860s, a woman by the name of Sally Hawley, who was a writer, she was a former abolitionist, women's rights advocate, decided to write an article about Harriet Tubman to help raise money, to help Tubman support her very large family in Auburn, New York, where she had settled with them. And Sally Hawley wrote an article and said something to the effect of, Maryland couldn't pay $40,000 for the capture of Harriet Tubman. Somehow that got translated later, you know, as the decades went on, that it was a $40,000 reward for her capture. And, of course, that never happened, and it was just the $100 reward. But it was just an offhand comment that Sally Hawley made. Now, why she picked $40,000, I don't know. I know that when John Wilkes Booth assassinated Abraham Lincoln and the government was out looking for Booth, they offered a $50,000 reward for his capture. Believe me, no one was spending $40,000 to try to capture a formerly enslaved woman.
That makes sense, considering the times and society
right.
at that time. Yeah, that would have been
right.
an absolutely exorbitant amount of money.
Right, and if they had offered that, she would have been caught.
Yeah,
someone would have turned her in. You know, that
definitely.
Was just millions and millions of dollars in those days.
Exactly. After the Civil War, she had so many other accomplishments as a suffragette. So many things. Can you talk about her other accomplishments and how she spent her last years?
So she was a devout humanitarian. She was a woman suffragist. She campaigned for the right to vote until the day she died in 1913. And unfortunately, in the United States, women did not get the right to vote till 1920. So I've always imagined how angry she must have been, because in 1870, black men were insured the right to vote, but no women could vote. So here she was, this woman that had rescued her brothers, other enslaved men, brought them north. She had fought during the Civil War. She was a leader of a group of Union spies, men, and yet they could all vote and she could not. I can just imagine how frustrating that was for her. So she constantly campaigned to earn the right to vote, or to get the right to vote, and she was a humanitarian. She helped anyone in need. She took in orphans into her home and took care of them. She took in sick people and took care of them, widowed women or women who had been abandoned. She took care of everybody. Her house was a safe haven for anyone in need. So she was constantly looking for money, always trying to raise money to support the so many people that were in her household. And she fought for equal access to health care that was segregated in the United States. You know, there weren't facilities, as many facilities for African Americans as there were for whites, and they were segregated and often not as good quality. And so she fought for that equality. She was pretty remarkable. I mean, really an amazing person. And towards the end of her life, she was able to purchase 25 acres of land next to her own 7-acre farm in outside of Auburn, New York, and she established the Harriet Tubman Home for the Aged. And it was her dream to provide sort of nursing home, rest home facilities for aging African Americans. And that site is now a national park and a museum in Auburn, New York.
That's so beautiful. And you know, again, a lot of people with especially what she went through in her life, in her early life before she escaped, so many people going through that would have been so bitter, but she just continued to give and pay it forward.
That's right. That's right. And the other thing, I think she grew up with this in the community that she was raised in, even as an enslaved person who was often separated from her family. The free and enslaved communities in Maryland raised everyone to take care of each other, because certainly a white community was not going to take care of enslaved people or free people. So she had this in her blood, in her being. In fact, when she was operating on the Underground Railroad and she would bring people to Canada to be safe because they were no longer safe in the United States after 1850 and the passage of the Fugitive Slave Act. Canada became a safe haven for freedom seekers leaving the slave South. And in St. Catharines, where she lived on North Street, she helped take in orphans there, too. There are records in the St. Catharines City Council minutes and meeting minutes, and it talks about Harriet Tubman petitioning the city to give her like a dollar a week to provide for orphans she was taking in off the streets. So even in the 1850s, when she's trying to survive herself, bringing people north to freedom in Canada, she's also taking care of orphan children that she's finding there on the streets. She was just remarkable.
She really was.
The energy she had, it's just incredible.
Yeah, and again, with having seizures and everything else that she was dealing with, and I think it was, like you said, it was that spirituality and that just inner strength that she had that just poured out, it seems.
Right, exactly.
Well, to read Kate's book and about the incredible life story of Harriet Tubman, I highly recommend reading or listening to her book, Bound for the Promised Land, Harriet Tubman, Portrait of an American Hero. You will learn so much. And Kate, thank you so much for speaking with me today.
Well, thank you for having me.
We'll return after this short break.
Hey, how's it going, folks? It's Tyler here. For your weekly fix of my weekly mix of rock and alternative music from the 90s all the way up to the current stuff, tune in a couple of nights a week for Alt Rock Overload, right here on Voices for Ability Radio.
There are three remarkable and tenacious women who will be forever intertwined, because without Laura Bridgman, who was the first deafblind person to learn to read and write, and Anne Sullivan Macy, the visually impaired teacher who taught Helen Keller to communicate, we may never have heard of Helen Keller. These three pioneers had one thing in common, the Perkins School for the Blind. Joining me today is Jennifer Arnott from the Perkins Research Library at the Perkins School for the Blind. Welcome to the show, Jennifer.
Hi there. It's great to be here.
Jennifer, most people have never heard of Laura Bridgman, who lived 1829 to 1889, even though she was the first deafblind person to be taught to read and write 50 years before Helen Keller. Why do you think her story is being so overlooked compared to others such as Helen?
I think in large part it's because Laura didn't go on to have a very public adult life, at least outside of Perkins. Some of that's just when she was born. It was less common for women to have an active public life for most of her lifetime. Helen, in her book, Midstream, My Later Life, talks about meeting Laura for the first time and says, from what I have read of Laura, I'm sure that she was bright and eager, and I believe that if she had had my teacher, she would have outshone me.
Wow, that's high praise.
Yes.
How old was Laura when she lost her hearing and sight? What caused it? Because I understand that she also lost some of her other senses, such as taste and smell.
Laura was about 2 when she became ill with scarlet fever. The illness killed both her 2 older sisters, and Laura spent almost a year recovering. She spent that entire year basically in bed. It was such a high fever that it also destroyed her sense of smell, and because so much of her sense of taste is based on smell, it effectively destroyed her sense of taste, too.
So how did she... Without those additional senses, how did she function as far as eating, things like that? Did she have special tricks that she used, things like that, in order to deal with that?
She was never a very hearty eater. Mm-hmm. But again, that was also common for women at the time. So it's a little hard to tell how much of that was purely Laura and how much of it was sort of other social conventions. She was an extremely skilled needlewoman and knitter and sewer. So I think she funneled a lot of her other senses into her tactile activities.
In the era when this happened to her, when she was a baby, most people at that time who were deafblind were considered basically hopelessly unreachable. How did her family find the Perkins School, and what made them reach out to Samuel Gridley Howe?
This is a great story because other people actually found her. She grew up in a small village right near Dartmouth College in Hanover, New Hampshire, and they were maybe 5 miles away. And in 1837, a student at Dartmouth was working on a census of the area, and so he was going to visit every household. And he discovered Laura, and the family sort of explained what had happened. And the student mentioned her to a doctor who was working at the college, And he mentioned her to Samuel Gridley Howe, who was the director of Perkins. Perkins was still a really new school at that point. It had only opened in 1832, so this is 5 years later. And Howe was really looking for more possible students, more possible outreach. They were trying so hard to get more word out and more awareness that the children who were blind could be taught. And he thought that working with somebody who was deafblind was even more powerful, maybe.
Well, and that's understandable because it would have been more of a challenge for him. Now, how did he initially get through to her, because it hadn't been done before, and what methods did he use to teach her language?
So we do know that there were a few people who were deafblind who had some very sort of basic language skills. So not abstract language, but being able to express their basic desires. So if they were hungry or they were tired or they needed something, but sort of very, very concrete things. The thing that was a huge breakthrough for Laura was that she was able to learn abstract language. Howe taught her to associate words with objects, usually by handing her an object, then reinforcing the word for the object. For the words, he used raised text, or sometimes he used blocks with letters, like children's blocks are, where the letters sort of raised on the wood. A series of female teachers also worked closely with Laura during this time, because teaching that way is obviously an incredibly time-intensive process. You have to have somebody there all the time responding and reinforcing the language.
And I would think, too, as with Helen Keller and Anne Sullivan, she would have had to have somebody with her round the clock just for everything, right?
Well, I mean, Laura was independent in terms of her own sort of daily getting dressed and washing and sort of managing her own room, mm-hmm. other than the things that actually require sight or hearing. But yeah, she did. The only way that you can communicate with somebody who's deafblind is by being right there, holding their hand, signing into it. So it's a very up close and personal. It takes a little bit more time, and it's not compatible with teaching multiple students. It's not compatible with lots of people sitting around a room and talking. There's just things that don't make sense for somebody who's deafblind that would otherwise make sense in a school for the blind.
That makes sense, exactly, that it's completely one-on-one. And I understand that she became internationally famous. Even girls were even poking the eyes out of their dolls to look like Laura. And she had a visit from Charles Dickens in 1842. How did Laura feel about being a celebrity on that level?
We don't know exactly. She did keep a number of journals. She kept dream diaries. She wrote a large number of letters to her former teachers and to friends and other people she'd met. I think that she understood that her being open and her being on display in some ways was really powerful for the school. So they would have open house days so that Howe could demonstrate that the students were learning. Again, the school was still very new. It was the first school for the blind in the United States that was chartered. There were only a handful open at that point. So even just any of this was brand new to people. Laura was a definite highlight of those open house days. People would gather around and watch her thread needles with her tongue. She would sew, she would knit, she would write. We have a lot of newspaper clippings saying that over 1,000 people came on a single day to see her. Just, it was very clearly a matter of real interest, and progressive education was a big thing in Boston at the time. All of these things sort of played into people being really curious about what she could do and how she learned it.
And I guess, you know, especially considering the time, that would have been a fascination for people, because they didn't think that somebody who was deafblind could do all of these things.
Yes.
Yeah, so it probably opened it up for a lot of other people seeing her and then taking that information home with them.
Yes, exactly.
Okay. I understand at one point she went back to live with her family, but her health started to deteriorate, so she went back to Perkins. What happened there? Why did she end up back at Perkins?
So her family farm was, and it actually still is, very remote. It's in a tiny little village, not near anything. The only people that there were there to talk to were her immediate family members and a few people who worked on the farm. All of them were incredibly busy, and they weren't able to sit down and communicate by manual sign. So Laura could help in the household. She could help with some cooking chores and, you know, other household things, but she couldn't really have a conversation with anybody for most of the day. We think that's the big reason that she became very unhappy. And so after a few months, arrangements were made so she could come back to Perkins. She did go back to visit regularly, so we know that she went back for a month or two many summers, but her home as an adult was at Perkins.
So it sounds like obviously when she was with her family, she was incredibly isolated because she couldn't communicate with anybody. So it makes sense. How did she spend the rest of her life? Did she live the rest of her life at Perkins?
She did. She worked extensively to friends, like I said, including her former teachers. But basically, she was the school seamstress, and she taught sewing to students. So you can imagine in the 1800s that there's a lot of just routine sewing that is taking place, because factory clothing is starting to come in, but isn't really there yet. So there's a lot of mending and making clothes and helping students learn how to do those tasks for themselves. And that's basically what she did. So we have a lot of photos of her at a sewing machine.
And she did it, obviously, all tactile. How did she differentiate between colors and things like that?
That part, we think that she had somebody help her with. That they would tell her what the color of yarn is or what the fabric was. We actually have a dress that she made in our archives that is really beautifully pieced. So you can see it has a pattern on it that sort of lines, and you can see that the lines line up correctly. And that the lace is attached so that it's even all around all the cuffs and things like that. So she was very, very skilled at that once somebody laid out what she was working with.
That is incredible. That's amazing.
Yeah.
Jennifer, Helen Keller, who lived 1880 to 1968, is the person that probably most people associate with the person being both blind and deaf who learned to communicate and thrive. And she accomplished so many incredible things in her life. But how did life start out for Helen? She was born both hearing and sighted, correct?
She was, yes. She lost her sight and hearing due to an illness when she was 19 months old. We're actually not sure about the cause. It was some sort of serious illness, but it's not clear precisely what it was. In Helen's autobiography, she mentions that they called it acute congestion of the stomach and brain. And that's the acute congestion of the stomach is also how it's referred to in a census record while she was associated with Perkins.
I understand that her mother found the Perkins School after reading the story that Charles Dickens had written about Laura Bridgman. Is that correct?
That is, yes. So when Dickens visited the United States, he wrote a book called American Notes. And he really didn't like America very much, but he really liked the trip to Boston, and particularly Perkins. So some years later, Kate Keller, who read a lot, read his American Notes. And Helen, in one of her biographies, describes her mother as despairing because Samuel Gridley Howe had died more than a decade before this. And Kate Keller didn't know if anybody knew his methods. There was not a whole lot of additional information about deafblind students learning things at that point. They were referred to an oculist in Baltimore who referred them to Alexander Graham Bell, who was heavily involved in education for the deaf at the time. He's, as you may know, a rather controversial person in the deaf community because of his emphasis on oralism, but he definitely knew people and teachers and resources. He advised the Kellers to write to Perkins and to see if there was somebody who might be able to help. And they did that in 1886 when Ann Sullivan was very conveniently looking for a job. She spent the fall and winter looking through Howe's notes, probably talking to Laura, who was still alive at that point, and in March traveled down to Alabama to start working with Helen.
And what was Helen's recollection of meeting Anne for the first time and her memory of that aha moment at the water pump? Can you explain what the aha moment was as well?
Yes. In Helen's autobiography that she wrote in 1906, The Story of My Life, she says, "I felt approaching footsteps. I stretched out my hand as I supposed to my mother. Someone took it, and I was caught up and held close in the arms of her who had come to reveal all things to me, and more than all things else, to love me." So it's very clear that from the very beginning, it was a very affectionate relationship. Anne actually brought her a doll, a gift from students at Perkins that had been dressed by Laura Bridgman, and the very first thing she taught her was the word doll. So for several weeks, Anne would spell words into Helen's hand. She would introduce objects, but Helen was really struggling to understand that different items were both dolls, so the one from Perkins and a big rag doll that she'd already had. And she really struggled to understand the distinction between water and the mug it was in. Eventually, Anne took her out of the house to the water pump and began to pump the water, spelling the word water into Helen's hand with her fingers. Helen describes the moment in a really beautiful way. She says, "Suddenly I felt a misty consciousness as of something forgotten, a thrill of returning thought. And somehow the mystery of language was revealed to me. I knew then that W-A-T-E-R meant the wonderful, cool something that was flowing over my hand." And after that, she never stopped. She describes walking around demanding words be spelled for her so that she could try and figure out how the world fit together and what these things were.
And didn't she learn, 30 words or something in the first day?
Yes, yes.
Incredible, incredible. Considering that it sounds like initially she had a harder time than Laura Bridgman had, but she caught up.
Laura also struggled. Laura, when she first arrived, it actually took a little longer for that breakthrough to happen. She also had one, it was about 4 months into Laura's time at Perkins, where Helen's breakthrough was about a month in.
Okay.
So one of the things that was really innovative about Anne's teaching was following Helen's guidance on what she was interested in, where Howard sort of done a more regimented, these are the words I will teach you in this order.
Right.
And there are theories that encouraged her to make the connections much faster because it was driven by her own interest.
So Anne almost had forward thinking, the more modern version we would think of education of follow the interest.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes.
Which, again, she was, by the sounds of it, very ahead of her time. And with
with
Helen being she was the first deaf-blind person to graduate from college, cum laude, no less. Was it a battle for her to get into college in the first place, or was the school eager to enroll her because of her celebrity?
It was definitely a battle. So there had been concerns about Helen overworking throughout her sort of teenage years. And there had been a number of challenges to her education and Anne's approach to her education when she was a teenager. Radcliffe also wasn't at all sure about admitting her. They thought that she wouldn't be able to benefit from the education, that it would distract students, that it would not benefit Helen. Helen described some of the comments she got in an article written after she finished college called An Apology for Going to College. People telling her, you have no books, you cannot hear lectures, you cannot make notes, you are most foolhardy to attempt something in which you are sure to fail. She points out quite rightly that the same argument was used a generation earlier against women going to college. Mm-hmm. So it was not new arguments. There were some really significant concerns that Anne would do her work for her. So there were some really extreme precautions taken for exams, that Anne could not be in the same building, that the material would be transcribed or signed by one person and the examination scored by another person, neither of whom knew Helen. So they were being very, very careful to make sure there could be no accusations that there was cheating or that Helen was being helped in her assignments in a way that was not appropriate.
And I think that's fair because nobody else there would have known if she was. Right,
yeah.
Because they wouldn't have been able to decipher the signs that were being given to her. So
yeah.
It sounds like that was fair, and obviously she did well. I mean, she graduated cum laude. Her celebrity, she used that to advance a lot of causes as an adult, particularly disability, human rights, women's rights. What else did she do, and what fueled that activism?
Had a really long history of championing causes and looking for ways to include people. So one of the earliest examples we have is that when she was 10, so she had been at Perkins in Anne's custody. She was a sort of visiting student at Perkins, I should say, but she was here for a number of years early on in her education. And she began fundraising to bring Tommy Stringer, a boy who was deafblind, who was about 5 at the time, to Perkins so that he could have an education like hers. And that's only the first of many examples. She helped fundraise for the Perkins Kindergarten, which opened around that time. And her social circles were full of people looking at progressive social causes, so it really makes sense that she continued as an adult. She was a pacifist. She was an early member of the ACLU. She was a socialist focused on workers' rights, all on top of her work for people in the blindness and deafblindness communities. She sort of narrowed her focus a little bit when she became a spokesperson for the American Foundation for the Blind in 1924, and she then worked for them for about 40 years. And like I said, at that point, she sort of refined her focus to talk about blindness and deafblindness and disability a bit more than the other issues.
It sounds like she was really trying to pay it forward for what had been done for her.
Yeah, I think she felt really strongly that people could benefit if they had the opportunity in a number of different ways, and she wanted to make sure that as many people had those opportunities as possible.
And she had a voice, and she used it, right?
Yes.
Yeah, in a positive way, which someone else may not have done that, but she decided to use it for good, which is amazing. What do you think Helen's legacy is today?
We get letters and calls every year, and I know there are even more people who come for tours who are still fascinated by her story. I think she's so compelling because of how well she was able not only to articulate her experience, but to make it clear that there's so many ways that people are excluded or limited when they don't need to be, whether that was disability or social or economic class or whatever other circumstances of their birth and childhood. Her writing is really beautiful, and it's really moving, and it's really thoughtful in a way that is really rare. She really was a gifted writer and speaker, one can say.
Well, that's wonderful, and I think that, you know, for people that don't know about Helen, younger people that are maybe still to learn about her and still learning about her, I think that will open up pathways for them of understanding.
Mm-hmm.
Jennifer, let's now talk about Anne Sullivan, Helen's teacher and lifelong companion, because the bottom line is if there hadn't been an Anne Sullivan, there wouldn't have been a Helen Keller. And with Helen's brilliance, we wouldn't have known about it. She wouldn't have been able to be involved in all of these causes if there hadn't been Anne Sullivan. Now, she's famous for being the person who was able to reach Helen But she had a very rough start on her own life and a visual disability as well. Can you talk about that?
Yes. Anne Sullen was born to a very poor Irish immigrant family in Western Massachusetts in 1866. She began to have trouble with her eyes by the time she was five due to trachoma, which most people don't know about. It's a bacterial infection that can cause scarring on the inside of the eyelid and damage to the eyes. It's still common in some countries, but it can be treated with antibiotics and surgery now. Anne's eyesight varied through her life. She had a number of surgeries. At some points in her life, she was comfortably able to read print, but later in her life, her eyesight grew very poor again. Her mother died of tuberculosis when she was eight, and just before she turned 10, she and her brother were sent to the Tewksbury Almshouse because the family was disintegrating and just couldn't support her. Her brother died of tuberculosis 3 months after they arrived. Almost everybody in the family had health issues. They were very poor with all the things that that could sort of bring on. She never went to school because there were no resources for somebody who was blind to go to school when she was a child.
And having not gone to school, how did she end up becoming a teacher for the blind at Perkins?
So Anne was never actually a teacher at Perkins in the sense of being on the staff, but she was a student. And so she had come to Perkins as a student at the age of 14. And there are a variety of stories about this, but she was at the Tewksbury Almshouse when a committee came to examine the almshouse. There were lots of stories about how bad the treatment was, how poor the conditions were. The sort of story that gets told is that she threw herself at the head of the commission and said, Mr. Sanborn, I want to go to school. And he had been a lifelong friend of Samuel Gridley Howe's. He knew about Perkins 3 months later and was a student. And 4 years after that, she was the school's valedictorian. So once she was given the opportunity to have an education, she really focused very hard on it. She applied all of her very, very fierce intelligence to it and learned a great deal. The problem was after graduation, she had to figure out what to do. She was staying with one of the Perkins house mothers at her home on Cape Cod for the summer when Michael Anagnos, the director of Perkins at the time, got the letter from the Kellers looking for a teacher, and he thought immediately of Anne and moved to offer her the job and the resources to figure out how to teach.
Does she talk at all about what, especially with all the tragedy that she'd gone through, everything that had happened, what made her want to become a teacher in the first place?
It's curious. I think she was really looking for a job that she could do, and teaching was the most appealing of the options. She knew she didn't want to do sort of some of the traditional work that people who were blind had gone into. She was not strongly musical. She didn't want to do sort of handcrafts. She hated sewing. So being a teacher was sort of the thing that she could see, but it required somebody to hire her. So the opportunity came at exactly the right moment when she was really trying to figure out what her options were.
It seems that way, and especially because even if she'd been sighted, there were so few options for women at that time as well. So teaching was one, whether you were sighted or not, was one option, one of the few, right? Did she ever marry?
She did. She married John Macy in 1905. He had become a friend to Helen and Anne while Helen was at Radcliffe, and he helped edit Helen's autobiography, The Story of My Life. They were married for about 9 years. They separated in 1914, but they never divorced. They were in contact through the rest of their lives. John Macy died some years before Anne. It seems to have been sort of complicated by the fact that they were living in a single household with Helen, that they were trying to figure out how Helen was going to spend her adult life. And there were a lot of pressures involved there. But she, at the end of her life, she spoke about him very fondly, sort of wishing that things had gone differently.
And that's what I wondered, because it would be very difficult to have a relationship and be married when you were also responsible for somebody else pretty much all the time, for them to be able to communicate. So it must have had an effect on her relationship.
Yeah.
Was it hard on her being with Helen pretty much 24/7 while she grew up and while she went through school?
I think she really enjoyed being with Helen. One of the things that I think is very true is that Helen needed her for specific things, or needed somebody to help with specific things, but Anne also very much needed a sense of purpose and, on a more practical level, someplace to live and a way to earn a living. So it's very clear as you sort of read their works, their comments as adults, that it was very much a mutual support and connection. It was not that Anne was doing everything for Helen. It was really that they were both getting things out of the relationship, and that chosen family that they often had trouble articulating was very important to them. I think that Anne really enjoyed what she was doing most of the time.
And it sounds like, you know, it was her destiny by the sounds of it. And again, we wouldn't have had known about Helen without Anne. So that all of that had to fall into place for this story to have happened and everything that they both accomplished.
Yeah, and I think they were really a tremendously good fit for each other personality-wise. So Anne was very scrappy is not a bad adjective here. She was very fierce about doing things the best way she could. She was very fierce about education. She was very fierce about advocating for herself and for Helen. And Helen was also a very independent-minded, strong-willed woman. They definitely had disagreements about different things at different points in their lives, but they were also very unified in the goals of what they were trying to accomplish and get people to understand.
And they did it. They did it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, Jennifer, thank you so much for joining us and enlightening us on all three women. It's been amazing and informative, and we thank you very much for being here.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you.
A part of their so-called act was later filmed. It is the only existing record of Annie Sullivan's voice.
When I saw Helen Keller first, she was 6 years and 8 months old. She had been blind and deaf and mute since her 19th month as the result of an illness. She had no way of communicating with those around her except a few imitative signs that she had made for herself. A push meant go and a pull meant come and so on. She had observed that we did not use the hands when we were talking to each other. And I let her see by putting her hand on my face how we talked with our mouths. She felt the vibration of the spoken word. Instantly, she spelled, "I want to talk with my mouth." That seemed impossible. But after experimenting for a time, we found that placing her hand in this position, the thumb resting on the throat, right at the larynx, the first finger on the lips, the second on the nose, we found that she could feel the vibration of spoken words. For instance, the throat, she feels the G, the hard G, the. And on the lips, she feels the, and the K sound, K. On the lips, she feels the B and the and the, with the second finger on the nose, the nasal sounds, the N, the M. The first word she learned to articulate was the little word it. With the hand in this position, I made the vowel I. She felt it. I. Then I made the T. She feels it with the finger on her lips. On my lips. Then I put the two letters together to form the word. It. And the first word was learned. After her seventh lesson, she was able to speak the sentence word by word. I am not dumb now.
We'll return after this short break.
What if we told you one of the leading disablers in Canada has a higher incidence rate than multiple sclerosis, breast cancer, and HIV/AIDS combined? What if we told you that this year alone, 160,000 Canadians will be affected? What if we told you, even though this condition is so common, many survivors and their families still experience social isolation and lack of understanding from peers and loved ones, a medical system that often doesn't have the answers, and a sense of hopelessness? So what is the leading cause of death and disability for Canadians under the age of 40? Brain injuries, caused by motor vehicle accidents, sports injuries, strokes, falls, heart attacks, cancer, domestic abuse, and countless other ways. It can happen to anyone at any time. But if you or your loved one is living with brain injury, You don't need to go through it alone. The Brain Injury Society of Toronto provides support, education, and information about how to survive and thrive after a brain injury. All of our programs are free and wheelchair accessible. No wait lists or medical documentation required. Want more information? Call us at 416-830-1485 to set up a visit. Visit us at www.bist.ca. Brain injury can happen to anyone, and no one needs to go through it alone. BIST is located at 40 St. Clair Avenue East, number 205, right above the Deer Park Library.
So first of all, let me assert my firm belief that the only thing we have to fear is fear itself.
Many people forget or are unaware that the 32nd President of the United States, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, who served four terms as president and saw the U.S. through World War II, had been stricken with polio in 1921. And while it was not a secret, his disability was very much downplayed for the public. Joining me today to talk about Franklin Delano Roosevelt is Jeff Urban, the education specialist for the Franklin D. Roosevelt Presidential Library and Museum. Welcome to the show, Jeff.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Jeff, for our listeners who may be younger and not aware of FDR's legacy, can you first give us some background on his early life before he was struck by polio?
Sure. Well, he was America's 32nd president, and he was president during two of the most tumultuous times of the 20th century, the first being the Great Depression and the second being World War II. And started his political career here in the state of New York as a New York State senator, and then went on to become governor, and then became president. But when he was 39 years old, in 1921, he contracted polio and never able to walk unassisted again. So he had a very active life up until the time that he contracted the polio. He loved to horseback ride and play golf, and in school he was in his drama club. So it was a real shock to him when he wasn't able to walk anymore.
When he contracted the polio in 1921, did he think his future was over, or did he just decide to forge ahead despite it? Did he struggle a lot with it?
Well, he never accepted the fact that he would never walk again. And, you know, for many, many years, actually for 7 years, he came home and he came here to Hyde Park and was working on trying to regain the strength of his legs and be able to walk again. And he also would go down to Warm Springs, Georgia, where he had a convalescent hospital down there. So he always believed that he was going to be able to regain the use of his legs, but he did take a sort of, a sidestep from his political career to spend the time to try to recuperate.
And it sounds like that inner drive is what drove him in his politics probably as well, right? That drive to push himself forward.
Yeah, both he and Mrs. Roosevelt always had the ability to see a better world out in front of them. First during the Great Depression and then with the Second World War, and certainly, Franklin Roosevelt with the polio, refused to see a world where he was going to be shut in and unable to, get out and do the kinds of things that he wanted to do. He wasn't able to walk, but he was able to do many, many other things, like lead a country through a Great Depression and lead a world through a Second World War. So those are the things that he chose to focus on, not what he couldn't do, but what he could do.
When he was governor and then subsequently the first time he was elected president and after that, what did he do to help Americans struggling during the Great Depression? And also, can you explain the New Deal?
Sure. Well, explaining the New Deal is a big order. But basically what the president was looking to do was to get the country moving again. We were suffering from the Great Depression here in the United States, and of course there was also a worldwide economic depression. And so he comes to power and he says the only thing we have to fear is fear itself. And what he means by that is that, there are options, there are things we can do, and we're going to start doing them. And the ones that work, we're going to keep, and the ones that don't work, we're going to get rid of. So what he began to do was, first thing was to pass a bank act, which stabilized the banks, which were closing, almost 1,000 a day in the United States. People were losing their life savings, and they weren't able to pay their mortgages, losing their homes. The first thing he did was stabilize the banks. And then he created the New Deal programs. And there were actually over 44 programs in the New Deal by the time he was done constructing the New Deal. And they were sometimes referred to as alphabet soup programs because they were known by their initials, like the AAA was the Agricultural Adjustment Act, the FDIC, the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, Social Security, SS. So But the thing that tied all of the 44 programs together were what we like to call the three R's: relief, recovery, and reform. So what he was looking to do was to bring about immediate relief to people who were suffering, to bring about recovery to the economy, get people back on the farms, get people back in schools, get people back in factories, get people back in their homes, and then reform, change the system so that we wouldn't have to go through this again. So that's what the New Deal was all about, relief, recovery, and reform, and he did it over the course of about 44 individual government programs.
And was TERRA, the Temporary Emergency Relief Administration, part of that group?
Mm-hmm, it was, yep.
And from what I understand, that helped to find jobs for the unemployed, and by 1932 it was helping one out of every 10 families in New York?
Yeah, the whole idea of of creating jobs was two things. Number one was obviously there's an economic stimulus. You create a job, now you got a paycheck, you can go out, you can buy things. That stimulates the economy and, gets things kind of moving again. But what FDR really understood was that when you lose your job, you lose a really important part of your identity. If you're a teacher but you have no students to teach, then are you really a teacher? If you're a farmer but you're not able to grow anything on your farm, are you really still a farmer? So FDR understood that we identify ourselves by the jobs that we have, and that if you lose that job, you lose a really important part of your identity. And then that leaves you open to despair. It leaves you open to, getting involved in things you shouldn't get involved with. And it leads you into giving up hope. And without hope, you've got nothing. So by giving people these jobs, he was giving them, yes, a little bit of paycheck, but also he was giving them a purpose. He was giving them a function. He was giving them something to do every day that they could feel good about and have pride in, and that helped to drive the economy as well.
It always impresses me the insight that he was able to pull up and to see what people needed. I'm always incredibly impressed by that.
Yeah, he really, he had a handle on what people needed.
And during his time in office, as far as his disability goes, it was very much hidden from the public. From what I understand, there was an understanding with the press about how they photographed or filmed him when he was in public, and there were a lot of ways that his disability was hidden. Why was that?
Right. I take issue with the word hidden. Yeah. It wasn't so much that it was hidden, but it was downplayed. There was sort of an unofficial agreement that you didn't take pictures of the president looking disabled, and we know of only 5 pictures of the president in the wheelchair. So that's a pretty good feat that only 5 pictures were ever taken of him in the wheelchair. Yeah. He didn't try to hide it so much as he tried to downplay it. He didn't want people talking about what he couldn't do. He wanted people talking about what he could do. So whenever possible, he might be in a room before everybody else and then have them come into the room so they wouldn't have to see him, struggling to, try to walk into the room or be wheeled into the room. And everybody knew that he had polio, but most people didn't realize to the extent that he had polio. He was really, when he first was impacted by it, he was unable to even lift a soup spoon. It impacted his entire body. Eventually, it settled in his legs, and he regained his upper body strength. But every year for his birthday, he would have what were called birthday balls. And there would be these parties thrown all over the country, and they were fundraisers to raise money to help fund his convalescent hospital down in Warm Springs, Georgia. And you could use the president's name, you could use his image, and the deal was that 70% of the money that was raised in a particular area had to stay in that area, and the other 30% was then sent to Warm Springs, Georgia to help with the hospital down there. So people sent him hundreds of canes because they knew that he was unable to walk, but what he did was he downplayed the extent of his disability, not so much hiding it, but downplaying it. So if you were to come to our museum, you're going to see pictures of him standing at a podium, and you'll notice that he's always holding on to the podium, or he's holding on to the arm of one of his sons or a naval officer. So he had these little, I guess you might call them tricks or techniques, that he would use in order to appear more able-bodied than he actually was.
Did that also have to do with the attitude towards disability at the time, and that was maybe the other reason why he needed to approach it the way that he did, aside from not wanting people to see the disability as opposed to what he could do?
absolutely. Yeah. You know, back in those days, the stigma around physical disability was that it often came with a mental disability as well. And so, you know, also at that time, if there was somebody in the family that was disabled, you know, a lot of times they would be relegated to a back bedroom, you know, and, you know, sort of second-class citizenship within the family and certainly within the society. And he didn't want that to happen to him, and he didn't feel that it should happen to anybody, really. You know, if you had the ability to, you know, to contribute, then what he wanted to do was to have those abilities, those attributes highlighted and, you know, downplay what couldn't be done. So he understood that, you know, in a nation that was literally crippled by a Great Depression, you know, we didn't need to see a president that was crippled by a disease, you know, and he wanted people to think of him as active, as, you know, fighting, as getting out there and making it happen. And, you know, that's in fact what he was doing, except he was doing it from a wheelchair.
Right. So the morale of the country was at stake.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And as far as the March of Dimes go, what was his role in founding it? And also, can you explain what the March of Dimes was when it was founded?
Sure. He had received a letter that a young man had polio and had gone to Warm Springs, Georgia, where the warm springs of the springs there actually helped in his rehabilitation. So President Roosevelt went down there to Warm Springs to test it out for himself, and he found that he did get some relief in the water down there. So it was an old resort, and he ended up, you know, it was all run down. He ended up buying it, and he eventually sunk about a third of his personal fortune into fixing up this old resort into a convalescent hospital. And then he opened it up to other folks, you know, with polio who could come there and seek treatment. The problem was it was very expensive. You know, wheelchairs, braces, doctors, you know, masseuses, all these things went into this, plus having to maintain the buildings. So it got to be very expensive, and what happened was they ended up creating creating the March of Dimes, which was to fund the operation of the hospital. Now, at the time, there was a newsreel called the March of Time, and so it was kind of a wordplay on that. So instead of the March of Time, it was the March of Dimes, and he encouraged people to send their dimes into the White House, and then those dimes were then used to fix and, you know, fund the Warm Springs, Georgia hospital. It was with that funding that Jonas Salk in 1955 used that funding to develop the Salk vaccine, which eventually put an end virtually to polio. So it was originally used to fund the hospital, and then it was used to fund research. And today the March of Dimes is still around. Having virtually annihilated polio, they now are focused on birth defects in little babies.
And before his death, he'd been helping to create what would become the United Nations eventually.
He died in 1945, April 12, 1945. Now, he died just 2 weeks before the first conference of the United Nations. And Harry Truman, who then became president, appointed Eleanor Roosevelt to be part of the American delegation to the United Nations. And Eleanor Roosevelt, you know, helped to create, as the chairperson of the Human Rights Commission, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And if you read the preamble of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the four freedoms are laid out there. So the four freedoms became sort of a fundamental call to action of the four basic things that everybody needs. They need food, they need to be able to express themselves, they need to be able to have worship however they like, and they need to be able to be free from constant anxiety and fear.
Well, Jeff, I think that, you know, we all strive for that, and hopefully one day we will reach all of those goals.
Well, again, yeah. You know, when they were put into effect in 1948, when the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was passed, you know, folks realized that, you know, these were lofty goals and lofty you know, lofty ideals. However, without a goal, without something to strive for, without something to look forward to, without something to work toward, you know, you really have no direction. And so although we have fallen short on many of these goals over the years, at least it gives us a you know, a milepost and a benchmark that we can judge our progress by.
Something to strive for. Absolutely.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yes. Well, Jeff, thank you so much for joining us today and teaching us a little bit more about Franklin Delano Roosevelt. It has been fascinating. Thank you so much for joining us.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
I hope you've enjoyed this episode of Beautifully Broken as much as I have enjoyed bringing it to you. Thank you to all of my wonderful guests for their insight and expertise. Thank you also to my audio engineer, Sean Pickard, and to Voices for Ability Radio and Connect for Life. The logo design for Beautifully Broken was created by artist Priya Lee. www.priyaalee.com. Some interviews were edited for time. To hear the full interviews, go to YouTube and search Beautifully Broken Podcast Episode 2 or my website at www.stephaniersaberan.com. If you would like to become a patron of Beautifully Broken, go to patreon.com, patreon.com, and search Beautifully Broken Podcast or Stephanie R. Sabaron. We'll be replaying our first episode December 27th at 7 p.m., but we will be back with a new episode January 31st, 2019 at 7 p.m., when I will bring you more stories and guests, and we'll be talking about the history of Hollywood and disability. Until then, let's look to the past in order to steer our future.
I am human.